I was thinking I should make a quick video on some updates on what I've changed and fixed on my electric RZR. So I thought maybe some of you guys might find that helpful. So here we go. Let's sit down in the cab and take a look at a couple things that I've changed from inside the cabin, which is, for start, the most helpful is this brake. This is emergency brake, if you will, that's hydraulically holds all the cylinders to a closed position so I don't have to use the park anymore. The park in these RZRs sometimes gets stiff if you're on a incline and you want to release the park. So that way I don't have to use the shifter at all. I just go ahead and leave it in high. So with this particular mod, there are a few companies that make these. This one I modified to have this hook all the way out here if it's easier to engage. So what you do is you push in the brake, move this brake over, and there we go. All four wheels are now locked. It's very helpful. So you just push it in, and now it's released. The other thing I changed underneath here is right here is electric power steering, helpful for long hauls and also for plowing because of the extra weight on the front. So those are two changes. I did also upgrade to modern RZR seats from a newer machine, which is a more plush ride. So the other one I'd like to talk about is the cooling in the engine and the controller. So let's take a look under here, as you should see underneath this hatch. So what I did here is I 3D printed a shroud. I mounted a 120 millimeter fan with a switch. And what this does is it blows this direction and cups the air going over the top and then also under the bottom. Let's take a look underneath here. See here, so it forces air. Let's get this way out of the way. Underneath, all the way under there. So it's been very helpful. The other thing I needed was cooling on the controller. With my design, I thought it'd be handy to have all this nice and compact. The downside is this controller was actually sitting right on this steel plate, as you might have noticed from my other pictures. What I had to do is I had to add a large heat sink. And this particular heat sink is a good inch thick. So that's key. So I sandwiched it directly onto the controller, and this is sandwiches all together. I put a thermal paste, of course. And what I had to do down here is I had to cut a hole and I put another 120 millimeter fan in there. What that does is it pulls air down and then also from the bottom up and then pushes it this direction onto the motor. So it turns out, since this is typically cooler, this is operating usually between 30 and 60 degrees Celsius maximum. So 60 degrees Celsius, even if that warm air was on this motor, that's cool, relatively speaking, because this motor can go up to 100 plus Celsius, almost up to 120. So it's okay to even take warm air and blow it on this motor. And it does help also push air on this back of the motor and also this pocket of air that tends to get stagnant. This helped a lot. This solved all of our problems on heavy riding. On trails, I never had an issue. What I had an issue was is when I was out on sand dunes and pushing the limits. So that's the third thing. Some might be wondering, why don't I have a radiator up here? Why didn't I go with liquid cooled rather than going with air cooled? It's just more complicated. You'd have to have liquid, you have to have a pump, you have to have a fan up front or around that pump as well. It's more complicated, more complex. And so with this smaller setup, I can keep it air cooled. But if you're going to go with a bigger motor than this, when you start getting above the Hyper 9, then you're going to probably need it. This is only 45, 50, 60 kilowatts. My Hyper 9 in my VW Beetle way back there, see it? It's only, 88 kilowatts, so you can get by with air cool. If you're going to go to a Tesla small drive unit, you're going to need liquid cool because you got a lot more power. You're double, triple the power. So the math says you'll need liquid cool then. But otherwise, no, you don't for these smaller machines. You don't need it. I would also like to mention that I don't have a winch on this machine, and I find having a smaller come along is much handier because a come along, I can also pull it from the back. I could also, if I rolled it over, I could pull it on the side, where a front winch would be of no use. If I need to pull anybody else, I could just put the strap that I carry with and just pull them out. So I don't carry a winch. So the question is, can you use a winch? Well, what it the limiting factor is your DC-DC converter. This particular converter has about a 60 amp maximum. So if I did want to put a winch on here, which is maybe 80 to 100 to 200 amp peaks, you may want to put in a small 12 volt battery. I just don't like the idea of having a lead acid battery. You could also use a lithium iron phosphate 12 volt battery in parallel with this little charging circuit. For me, I don't need it, just adds more complexity. So I just stay away from that. I have a plow, by the way, and what I do is I use a hydraulic lift. How do I use a hydraulic lift on a plow? This is my older plow, straight plow. Here is a electric hydraulic lift. Basically what it does is you attach it to the machine and they could pull up a plow in place of a winch. It's more efficient, uses less current. I don't need any 12 volt batteries because this is a lower current draw. This can work with my DC-DC converter as is. Now recently, I did upgrade to even a bigger plow. Let's take a look over here. I've got this huge V plow and it has a built-in hydraulic system. It's an even bigger unit. It has a larger hydraulic because it's this whole thing here is a V plow that's 350 plus pounds. I'm excited to try this winter. Obviously it needs a bigger hydraulic pump. This could take up to 100-150 amp draw. A peak, not long, but just short peaks. So I'm going to set up a lithium iron phosphate battery, just mounted a 12 volt battery on it, and then just charge it separately and just use it. I don't want to keep a 12 volt battery in my unit. So that's what I'm talking about when I say you could use hydraulics for plows, and then a manual come along to pull yourself out. While we're in here, I'd like to talk about these quads and the modifications I made it in regards to cooling. It's about the only modification I made. This unit here was overheating just a little bit. This one has a zero brand motor, which is more efficient, and they're just create less heat and also less work on the controller. And also with that coupled with great airflow, all I needed was one fan and a small heat sink on this. And that solved all the issues. And this fan blows downward, so it also hits these fins that doesn't have airflow. So this has airflow across the top. And then as you can see here, the skid plate has a square hole in the bottom and there's a gap in here that pulls in air right across the bottom of that motor. So this one has been solved with one fan. They're working great now when I push it hard in the sand dunes. Meanwhile, this unit, I didn't have that room and it has the Mont Energy motor in it, which isn't as efficient. So it does, I can notice it does take a little bit more current, and I pushed it back to here. And what this allowed me to do is add in a real thick heat sink, and it's hard to see it in here because it's covered completely because I have a channel underneath it. This cover allows me to pull in air from the front through the back, and then this 3D printed shroud pulls this air out this direction. So as I'm moving forward, it has a nice flow from air from front to back. This has solved the issues with this unit. This has been working great now. I'd like to talk about, and I think it'd be best just to show in video, is I upgraded this belt to a continental silent sink. Let's step back and talk about the history, evolution of what systems I've already tried. Yeah, I tried a chain. A lot of people, well, that's the first thing going on. I did the same thing. I thought this would work great. It turns out this is loud and it will overheat. You think, well, with my quads, I use a chain. Why doesn't it overheat? Well, it doesn't weigh as much as this and it doesn't have as high of RPM. I will go up to almost 7,000 RPM. Where in the quad, I only go to 4,000 RPM max. It's just the way their ratio works. So this did not work. So then the cheaper version of a belt would be a typical cogged belt. This cogged belt you would recognize used in superchargers with vehicles. It turns out this did work, but there was a high pitched whine. Throw a picture in here to show you what frequency was at. turns out that that high pitch frequency is recognizable. Go listen to a supercharger. There's a high pitched whine on a V8 supercharger. It turns out that high pitched whine, a big part of that is the pitch of the slap of this bell. And it was annoying. This should be completely silent. My understanding too is that the Polaris Kinetic, they use this bell too. And the biggest complaint with it is it's not really completely silent. It has a high pitched whine. It's because of the bell. The solution to that is been mentioned by EV West. They say they swear by this bell. The reason why a lot of people don't want to go to it is it's more expensive. These are cheap. You can get these for $10. This here is $80, $90. This has already lasted me a season. It's been working great. I don't even have a shroud over it, and it's completely silent. It's the solution. So let me take another closer look here. So you see this V pattern in it? There you go. And that's the key. This system here is a universal pulley system. You buy different inner pieces for different diameters, and then you buy the outer piece with different sets of teeth. And that's how you can change gear ratios. If I wanted to, if I want to change the gear ratio, I could do that easily by just buying different units. So now you see it, now you see it exists. And then just keep that in mind. If you're building one, put a shroud on it. I just haven't taken the time to do it. I just leave it out in the elements, because what happens is it does get a little dry, especially from the sand dunes and that kind of thing. And it will have a little bit of a squeak. And the odd thing is you think, well, belt dressing, right? Wouldn't that solve that? It turns out, no. The solution to that is a off-road chain lube. Yeah, you think that this would gather materials, but it doesn't. It's designed to throw off that debris like on a chain. So yeah. Chain lube on your V belt, completely silent. Let's hop on in and I'll show you what I mean. So here we go, no noise. All you hear is creaking of just suspension, just plastic creaking. There we go. You can hear the wheel noise on the pavement. Hear that difference of the wheel noise versus on the dirt or on the grass? So here, we'll show you again. Wheel noise is about all you hear. Completely silent. Also, I'd like to note that the PC fans that I showed you, they're on. You can't hear them. Imagine if I was hunting and I wanted to just sneak up on a stand. Or if I just want to go for a ride, enjoy the sound of nature. Much more enjoyable. Like to point out that because I don't have the internal combustion engine, the excess heat. Now remember, when you drive any internal combustion engine, only 20% drives you forward. The other 80% is inefficiency waste heat. That waste heat just blows on your face. It comes from the radiator, it comes on up. Side-by-sides are notoriously hot. They're uncomfortable. Even quads are uncomfortable. You ride, especially if you're in the desert, in the sand, because of that extra heat coming through. I like to point that out, so that it's nice and cool to ride in as well, because there's just no waste heat in an electric motor. They're 90s efficiency, so there's only 10% of that is wasted heat. Now, yes, here's the electric VW. It's done. Next, I'll be making a video on it. So stay tuned and we'll do a walkthrough and go into details about this. Got a few thousand miles on it already.